So all the optical components in your path for your EUV photons have to be mirrors. And that includes the mask, which essentially is a patterned mirror. So where you want to pattern, you reflect the light back at those points, and where you don't want to pattern, you just let that light pass through. So even the mask, which is used for EUV, is essentially a patterned mirror. And then you use these mirrors again to focus these incoming photons and focus it to your wafer. And these mirrors are not the typical mirrors that you use in your house. These are very special kind of mirrors, and this describes essentially what each of these mirror is. So each of these mirror essentially consists of around 50 of these bilayers, and each of these bilayer is composed of a layer of silicon, which is a few nanometers thick, and a layer of molybdenum, which is again a few nanometers thick, and together they essentially form a Bragg reflector, which has reflectivity centered around the wavelength of 13.5 nanometer. So it has its maximum reflectivity at that particular wavelength. So it will reflect light coming back at 13.5 nanometer, and it will not reflect the other light. And even with all this sophisticated bilayer stack and 50 of these bilayers, what you get essentially is a reflectivity of 70%, or reflectivity of 0.7. So for 100 incoming photons, you only reflect 70 of them back. So again, this points to the amount of inefficiency that you generate from this optical path. And so each of these mirror has a reflectivity of only around 70%. So suppose you were starting with a light source which had an energy of around 27 watt. So by the time you get to your first mirror, that what you're left with is just 6 watt. And by the time you get to your mask, what you're left with is just 550 milliwatt. And by the time you focus it and get to your wafer, you are left with just 30 milliwatt. So for each of these photons, only 1 by 26th of them actually make it to the wafer. The rest are just lost in these optical path because each of these mirror has a reflectivity only of 70%. So this points to how inefficient your whole EUV business is. So this table again highlights the efficiency or the lack of efficiency in EUV. So suppose you need a dose of 30 millijoules on your resist. That's the typical sensitivity that you require for your resist. So what you need to achieve that much dose on your resist is you need around 1 watt on your first. The mirror is just facing the wafer, and to generate that 1 watt on your mirror, which is just facing the wafer, you need a source of 130 watt. And to generate that 130 watt of source, also since the process of generation of these EUV photons is also not so efficient one, you actually run a meter on your clock, which is connected to your EUV machine. The meter of that will run at 500 kilowatt just to generate this required amount of dose. So there's a lot of buzz around green fabs and reducing the energy consumption in fabs, and certainly going to EUV is not going to help. This power that you clock, power that you require is at least several times higher than what you would get with a deep UV or a argon fluoride based laser. So that brings you, so there are two ways to go about it. One is to reduce, make this whole process more efficient and reduce this power consumption. The second thing one can say is, okay, I cannot increase my incoming light too much, but can I play with the resist now? Can I make the resist more sensitive? So that brings us to this last challenge of the three challenges I described. That is a challenge with the resist that you require for EUV. So what's so special? What's the deal about this resist? So the one of the main challenges with the EUV resist is that now it has to suddenly deal with first of all, photons which have a much higher energy. So all the previous resists were designed for photons which had a resist had an energy of 6 to 7 eV. Now suddenly the energy which is hitting this resist is going to be 92 eV. So what if you hit your resist with the photons of this high energy? You'll generate secondary electrons. You'll generate photoelectrons. These secondary electrons and photoelectrons, they add to something known as the resist flare. And what it leads to is essentially degradation in your image quality, in your image fidelity. The second challenge with this EUV resist is that since EUV generation as well as the optics of EUV is so inefficient, they have to deal with a much lower dose. So typical deep EUV resists, they are designed for a dose in hundreds of millijoules per centimeter square. But since EUV is such an inefficient process, the way people want to design around is that let's design resist which requires a much lower dose. So people want EUV resist to operate at a dose of 10 millijoules per centimeter square, which is the target. More realistic resist operates around 30 millijoules per centimeter square. The problem when you operate at such a low dose is your line edge roughness. And it's not very hard to postulate why that would be the case, why your sensitivity and your line width roughness will go inverse to each other. And this data, experimental data showing that sensitivity in fact is inversely proportional to your line width roughness. So more the sensitivity you have in your resist, you get a lower line width roughness. What a higher sensitivity means is now that you need much higher dose of incoming photons to form your patterns, and that essentially dictates that you have low line width roughness. Versus if you have a low sensitivity of your resist, then you need a much lower dose to form that pattern, and then again individual one or two stray photons can introduce a lot of variation in your line width. So that's as we see that experimental data actually falls right on that inverse relationship curve. So if you have less dose required, or you have a lower sensitivity for your resist, your individual photons can cause now a much higher change in your width of your pattern, and you get a much higher line width roughness. So that summarizes the grand challenges in the field of EUV. And in the next video, we take a look at how things stand by the end of this calendar year, where things are in the UV world.